Right, welcome to the last week, week 8 of 4DS Pre-Calculus. This is just day 2. We're doing review. I'm just cranking these movies out to help you out. Alright. So day 2 of our review. We'll have one more day tomorrow. There's the question. How many terms are in that expansion? Well, somebody realized that if that's an exponent of 10, then there's one extra term, right? Because a plus b to the 1 has 2 terms. A plus b squared is 3 terms. A plus b cubed is 4 terms. So guess what? Something and something raised to the 10 is going to be 11 terms, right? So the answer is one more than what the exponent is. And I think it even says it on our reference notes, or cheat sheet. You know there's an extra one because you start counting at 0, right? N choose 0. Now all these questions are from January 2010 exam online. You've had these practice questions for a couple months, and I got to put this on here. Not a couple months. Well, you've had access to them for months on my website, but I handed them out 3 weeks ago. And this is all government Manitoba stuff. It's legal to copy it, so I guess I'll just give them some credit here. Carry on. Solve this equation. Well, you know what? You could technically solve this with exponential equations without needing logs, because you notice that 8 is really a couple 2s, well, 3 2s to be specific, multiplied together. So since you can turn both bases into the same base, but the log method will always work. So let's just go straight to the log method and quit messing about. So you're going to take the log of both sides. And when you pop down that x plus 1 on the right side, make sure it's in brackets when you bring it down, because that's all of x plus 1 was the exponent, not just x. If you don't put brackets, it'll look like it's x plus 1 log 2, as opposed to being x plus 1 bunches of log 2. So put it in brackets. And then you multiply it out on the right side, so you get everything in x's, not x plus 1's, and then you'd bring the x's, get them together on the same side, so I dragged them from the right over to the left. And now I got, on the left, I got some number of x's minus another number of x's, because don't forget log 8's just a number, and log 2's just a number, log 2's 0.3. So you got some number of x's minus some number of x's, so it's really just that number of x's by factoring it out, and all that equals log 2. So you're going to divide left and right side by that log 8 minus log 2. Now, of course, this is kind of ugly. I could have made it a little prettier, right? Isn't log 8 and minus log 2 in the denominator really log 4? Right? 8 subtracting logs is the same as the log of their quotient. Remember the quotient law? And of course, so you could grab your plastic brain and smash in base 10 log of 2 divided by base 10 log of 4. It'll tell you 0.5, but you don't need a plastic brain, because you might have recognized by looking at the bottom line there, the purple line, that hey, if that was a base 2 logarithm, the base 2 log of 2 would be 1, and the base 2 log of 4 would be 2. So the answer is 1 over 2. Nobody says you had to use the base 10 log. You can use whatever log you want. Sometimes it's handier just to use a sensical one that you can do without a plastic brain. So really, if you understand logs, this is no harder than solving in grade 8. What I got in the red side there, 3x equals 1x plus 1. Right? If you can solve 3x equals 1x plus 1, well, with the few extra steps before it, you can do logarithms. There's not much new under the sun in algebra. Every grade you learn one extra little sort of step that might be a good tool in your toolbox. Alright? Or here we go. Here's where I showed you the exponential way of doing it. Pretend you didn't know logarithms. You could have said, well, 8's really 2 raised to the 3. And you know that 2 raised to the 3 raised to the x, because of the correction, the power law of exponents means you can multiply the 3 and the x together. So you really got 2 to the 3x equals 2 to the x plus 1. So if 2 to my shoe size is the same as 2 to your shoe size, that can only be true if my shoe size is the same as your shoe size. So toss away the 2s, the bases there, they serve no purpose anymore. And since it can only be true if 3x equals x plus 1, a bit of grade 8 math will tell you that x equals 1 half. Misspelled exponential. All right, thank you very much, Angela. You got this one. What exponent do you put on a 2 to get 2 to the 10th? Say it to yourself. What exponent do you put on a 2 to get 2 to the 10th? Isn't it 10? Because that log 2 undoes the 2 exponented to the 10. So you're just left with whatever the exponent is. Just say to yourself what an exponent is. It's amazing how talking to yourself works. Not that I would know. Question 31. The exact value of sine of negative 5 pi divided by 6. So you're pretty sure now you won't be able to use a calculator, although a calculator would have worked quite nicely in this, and it would have given you the exact answer. All right, you could have just smashed it into a calculator in this particular case. Anyway, if you want to see it on your unit circle chart, you'd have to realize that being at negative 5 pi divided by 6 was the same as going frontward 7 pi divided by 6. Right, they're called co-terminal angles. So all you really got to do is take that negative 5 pi divided by 6 and you say to yourself, well, gee, I want to wrap it one more time clockwise, correction, the proper direction, anti-clockwise, and end up at the same spot, so it won't be a negative number. So how do you go once more around the circle in the proper direction? Don't you add 2 pi? And to add 2 pi, don't you need the same denominator? So don't you really add 12 pi divided by 6? So if you add 12 pi divided by 6, you end up with 7 pi divided by 6. And then you can read it off your unit circle chart. So the cosine is negative root 3 over 2, and the sine is negative 1 half. In actual fact, a calculator would have told you that. But when I asked for exact values, no calculator would tell you the proper answer if there was a square root in there. All right, so there's how I trick you. I say you can use calculators, but then I arrange it so the calculator won't do much for you anyways. What is the period of the tangent of x, or, well, tangent of theta, same thing. Tangent of an angle. You can only do tangents of angles, so it doesn't matter whether you call it theta or x. And there goes my software again. Just blew up. Software. There we go. So the software blew up for a second there. Turns out the period is 180 degrees. All right. And let's just be clear about that. Let me just go back. Oh, yeah. So the period is 180 degrees. All right. So I drew it for you because I just gave you an example. Say you were at position 3 to the right, 4 up. Well, you would say your opposite over your adjacent was 4 over 3, or 4 thirds. But there's another place when your period could be, correction, where your tan could be 4 thirds, if you were 3 to the left and down 4, because negative 4 over negative 3 is still 4 thirds. So it's going to repeat itself every 180 degrees. Because whether you go 3 to the right and 4 up, or 3 to the left and 4 down, you're still ending up with the same ratio, so the same tangent. And maybe you'll remember that. So I drew you the sine curve there. Sine repeats itself every 2 pi, every 360 degrees. But the tangent repeats itself every 180 degrees, or every pi radians. And we had graphed it. And, well, this is one of those things you got to sit and doodle. Right? You got to get into the videos or the notes. It's all in the notes. I know we didn't spend a lot of... Well, no, we did do the tangent graph. It was kind of fun. And we did the cotangent, too. Okay, so, but somebody had asked me why was that true, so I just showed you. All right, so in this instance here, here was the question. They gave you the baby. They said, here is half of what the function looks like, so tell me what the function looks like. So they're saying, here's the baby. What did the mummy look like before it was squished? So wasn't the mummy going to be twice as big? Yeah, so it's sort of a bass-ackwards question. They tell you what the baby looks like. What did the mummy look like? There's the answer. The baby had gone through a vertical compression by a factor of what I call 1/2. Find the exact value of the cosecant of 270 degrees. Ooh, we stayed with degrees. Well, you don't have cosecant on your chart, on your unit circle, but you have sine, and you know that cosecant is 1 over sine. So all you got to do is do 1 over the sine of 270. Well, the sine of 270, I'm showing you there, if you go around the circle 270 degrees on a Ferris wheel, don't you end up 0 left and right and negative 1, like all the way down to the bottom on this unit circle? A circle with a radius of 1, unit circle. Well, you do. You end up 0 left and right, which is a cosine, and negative 1 down, which is the sine. So what's 1 over negative 1? Sounds to me like it's negative 1. Yeah. Or on your calculator, just type in sine of 270, and then hit your x to the minus 1 button, and it'll flip it upside down. That's, you got a button that divides things into 1. It's called your 1 over x button, or your x to the minus 1 button. Or just do it on paper. There you go. Oh, this was a toughie. So you're given the function at the left there. So it looks as though it's something that starts at the black dot, and it goes all the way to the right, and it goes all along the y equals negative 2 line. So what is the reciprocal? So we're going to reciprocate that. So every point on the left graph is going to be turned inside out. Sort of like innie and outie belly buttons, I guess. I don't know. So all the negative 2s on the left graph are going to become 1 over negative 2s. Well, isn't 1 over negative 2 negative 1/2? So all the points that were negative 2s become negative 1/2. So looks to me like you got pretty much the same line going off to the right. It's a ray, actually. It's not a line, because lines go both directions. So you got the ray going off to the right, except it's at negative 1/2 instead of 2, because 1 over negative 2 is, correction, 1 over 2, 1 over negative 2 is negative 1/2. All you did was flip it upside down. You're flipping the y's upside down. Find the measure of an angle between the hands of the clock at 4 a.m. I'm sure you guys will be studying all this stuff before 4 a.m., so you'll see this. Guess what the answer is? 2 pi divided by 3 radians. Aren't you 1/3 of the way around the clock when you do that? Isn't 4 1/3 of the way back to 12? So if you're 1/3 of the way around the clock, around the full circle, well, what's a full circle? A full circle is 2 pi. So what's 1/3 of 2 pi? Isn't it 2 pi times 1/3? Which we could also call 2 pi divided by 1, just 3. So if you're 2/3 of the way to a semicircle, or, right, or 2 1/3 of the way to a full circle, well, then you're at 4 a.m. Now you'll wake up at night and you'll be calculating this in your head. And I did some other ones there. What's 6 a.m.? Well, 6 a.m., the hands would be opposite each other, 180-degree angle to each other. Duh, that'd be pi radians. Or you'd be 2 90s, 2 pi's divided by 2. Or you'd be 2 pi divided by 2, because 2 pi's a full circle, and you're dividing by 2 because you're halfway around the full circle. So 2 pi divided by 2 sounds like pi. What's 10 a.m.? 10 a.m., you'd be 10/12 of the way of a full circle of 2 pi. Well, 10 twelfths is really 5 sixths, so it's really 5 sixths of 2 pi, which is really 10 pi's divided by 6, which is really 5 pi's divided by 3. So at 10 a.m., you could say, oh, the time is 5 pi divided by 3 radians. Maybe we should convert time into radians. Maybe we should do that. I always thought we should do decimal time and have, like, centi days, but maybe we should just do time in radians. Yep. I'll see you in pi 30ths of an hour. That'd work for me. And here's 3 and 1. 3 for the price of 1. We'll supersize this one. Question A says, you take that function on the left there, the big one, the function, the parent function, and you're going to go 2 times the value of the function when it's evaluated at x take away 1. So the x take away 1, that means all the x's are going to shift to the right by 1. And the 2 means all the y's are going to be stretched by 2. All right, so all you're going to do is shift the 3 points there, 1 to the right. So I'm just taking the 3 corners of that diagram, shifting them 1 to the right. And then I'm doubling whatever the y is. So check out the left-hand point there. It was at negative 2, comma, negative 2. So it is going to go to, it's going to shift to the right. So it'll become negative 1, comma, negative 2. And then the y's will double. So instead of being negative 1, negative 2, it'll be negative 1, negative 4. So all your y's just double. Right? So if they're negative y's, they get doubly negative. I can't get doubly. They get doubled negatively, and if they're positive y's, they get doubled higher. So, yeah, you're allowed to double negatives, you know. And my second one, B, y is the inverse function of x. That's the proper way to read that. And that's where you just swap the x's for the y's. Okay? So that negative 2, negative 2, they swap and they become a negative 2, negative 2. It doesn't change. The 0, negative 2 becomes a 2, negative, correction. The 0, comma 2 becomes a 2, comma 0. All I did was swap the x's and y's. And then the 3, comma 3 becomes a, I swapped the 3 for the 3 and the 3 for the 3, so it doesn't change. So you end up with that pretty little diamond shape in there. And then finally, what is Charlie? All right. Question C says, you take the function at negative x and then subtract 2. Well, by changing all the x's to negative x's, you're reflecting the function through the y-axis. In other words, you're flipping it across the y-axis. And by using the negative 2, you're dropping everything, or translating or shifting is the better words, down 2. All right, so all your x's are going to change sense. So all positive x's become negative x's, and all negative x's become negative negative x's, which really means they're going to become positive x's. And then all your y's drop by 2. That's what it says. Here's what she looks like coming at you. Here we are. All the positive x's get changed to negative x's and drop 2. And then, of course, when your x is 0, it's pretty hard to change the sign of a 0. The zeros don't change. They stay where they are. But in this case, it just dropped 2. And then that other point there, the 2, negative 2. Well, instead of being a negative 2 for the x, it became a positive 2. And then it dropped down. The y dropped down 2. So there you go. If you actually just copied that, you could actually copy the figure. We did it in class. If you take that red thing and you slip it up 2, and then you flip it, although the proper word is reflect it, across the y-axis, they're the same curve. It's the same function, just got a little adapted a bit. Transformed is the proper word. Oh, everybody's favorite. The secant of pi divided by 3 times the tan of negative 7 pi's divided by 6 times the sine of some mystery angle equals 1. So find the mystery angle. It's just an equation. Well, of course, the secants went over the cos, and the tan is, don't forget, it's on your reference notes, tan is cos, correction, sine over cosine. So you can find the sine of negative 7 pi's divided by 6, once you find the coterminal angle. And times the sine of the mystery angle is 1. So those all are just numbers, and there's one unknown there. It's an equation. If there's only one unknown, you can solve it. So let's go. So the first one's easy. The first factor, 1 over cos pi divided by 3. Well, pi divided by cosine of pi divided by 3 on your cheat sheet is 1 half. All right, so that first factor is 1 over 1 half, which is obviously 2. Now, how do you do negative 7 pi's divided by 6? You've got to realize that that is coterminal on your unit circle chart with 5 pi's divided by 6. All right, 5 pi divided by 6 is the same as negative 7. It's not the same, but you end up at the same place. So the same sine and cosine as negative 7 pi's divided by 6. And you end up at the same place as negative 19 pi's divided by 6. And you end up the same place as negative 31 pi's divided. See, I'm just adding or subtracting negative, or adding or subtracting 12 pi's divided by 6, or negative 43 pi's divided by 6, or all of those, or 17 pi divided by 6, and then add another 12 pi, 29, 41, 53, right? You end up at the same spot just by going around an extra turn. So all you wanted to do was turn that negative 7 pi divided by 6 into 5 pi divided by 6 radians, because that's on your reference notes, and then you can find it on your, the exact value on your unit circle. I mean, you could smash all this into a calculator, and it would give you an answer, but it wouldn't be an exact value. Actually, would this one have worked? Oh yeah, this one would have worked just doing it on your calculator anyways. But I'll arrange it so they're usually exact values, so the calculator won't help you, just to be a nice guy. And then I'll be able to tell if all I get is a decimal answer that you just used your calculator. All right, so we got that straightened away. So the sine of negative 7 pi divided by 6 divided by the cosine of negative 7 pi divided by 6 is really 1 half over the negative square root of 3 over 2 times the sine of the angle equals 1. All right, so I'm on like line 2 there. So that's 2 times, and when you do that second factor, it turns out negative 1 over root 3, and I won't bother converting that properly because it's just going to get manipulated anyways, times the sine of the thing. So it's negative 2 divided by square root of 3 times the sine of the angle is 1. So you want to find the sine of the angle, so you divide both sides by negative 2 divided by root 3, which is really the same as multiplying by the reciprocal root 3 over 2. And blah, 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 so you end up with, what do you end up with here? Oh, so then you're saying, well, what angle has a sine of negative 3 over negative root 3 over 2? And you look on your cheat sheet, and you notice there's two angles where the y, or the up and down, on the Ferris wheel is at negative root 3 over 2. So that happens at 240 degrees or 300 degrees, which of course is Erkeling numbers. The proper way to say it in radians is 4 pi divided by 3 or 5 pi divided by 3. And the question said, just give me one answer. So you knew there was two. Actually, there's an infinite number. But one answer is 4 pi divided by 3. Or 5 pi divided by 3, or, 11 pi divided by 3, or keep adding 6 pi, 17 pi divided by 3, 23 pi divided by 3, 29 pi divided by 3, 35 pi divided by 3, 41 pi divided, well, there's an infinite number of answers. There you go. And somebody was asking me again, why is tan the same as the sine over the cosine? So I went back to basics here. Here we go. Here's the diagram. I drew a triangle inside our unit circle, so I gave it a hypotenuse of 1. You know that the tangent of an angle is the opposite over the adjacent, if you're an old Greek from 3,000 years ago. But we decided to put it inside circles and grids, Cartesian grids, right? We have only had those for like 500 years. So instead of being opposite over adjacent, it's the y over the x. But you know that on the unit circle, if the hypotenuse is 1, that the y is really the sine and the x is really the cos. So whether you call the tangent the opposite over the adjacent, or the y divided by the x, or the sine divided by the cosine, it doesn't matter. You're saying the same thing. It's kind of an important thing to get in your head, I suppose. I know we've discussed it thoroughly in the notes. Check out some of the videos on my playlist or something. Alright, so now we're into the June 2010 practice exam. Heck, this will be like the second. You've had many of these practice questions, and I've got more practice questions than we can possibly print. So solve the following algebraically. Well, right away you see that the bases aren't commensurable. You can't make 7 out of 3s or 3s out of 7, so just go straight to logs. In fact, always go straight to logs. So take the log of both sides, apply the rules in the first line there. Alright, take the log of both sides, and I sort of cheated the first line. When I took the log of the left right hand side, I split it up because you know that the log of 7 plus the log of 3 raised to the x plus 1 is really the same as the log of their product together. And then I use the law that says I can pop the exponents down in front in the second line in green. And then I'm still looking for x, but it's sort of buried in with 2x's minus 5, so I multiply everything out. I'm getting closer to getting x's by themselves. That's the black line. Now I see I got, in the black line there, I've got x's on the right and x's on the left. So let's take all the x's with their coefficients on the right and move them to the left. And let's take all those constant numbers, like negative 5 times log 7. That's just a number. It's like about negative 5 times, I don't know, what's the log of 7? 0.8? Yeah, it's about 4. So it's moving off to the right. And swap a little bit of fancy math there. Factor out that x in the red line. Look at that. I'm going to be getting x all by itself. Well, that's the aim of algebra. Find the x. A little bit of fancy math here. You could get fancy, and instead of saying on the left side 2 log 7 minus log 3, you could apply some fancy math and say that's really the log of 49 divided by 3, if you think about what I'm saying. Or just carry out this. Now, when you're doing this, if you're just smashing this into a calculator, you know, you may want to compute the numerator, the top, and the denominator separately, you know, fairly accurately, and then calculate it. Because when you guys were smashing all this into the calculator, you know, unless you're very careful with your brackets, you always put brackets in the top, and you always put brackets in the bottom if it's more than just a single number, you can cock this up. The answer ends up being 4.5732 dot 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 dot. Alright? And then I actually checked that answer. I took that 4.5732 and I stored it as in my memory. In this case on the T83, I stored it as the variable A. And the left side ends up being, back in the original equation, 3193 dot 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 dot, and the right side, when you plug in the x, becomes 3193. Yeah. So always check your answer if you get a chance, and it's kind of handy if you know how to use that memory button on your calculator. It'll memorize a complicated number. And all I did here was I showed you that you could have, even though you're not allowed to graph, you can graph this crap, right? So it took me about 2 minutes to do this. I showed you that it could be graphed, and you'll notice the answer is about, the x is about 4.5 and a bit. So you can actually graph all problems. If you were doing applied math, this is the way you'd do it. And in reality, if you're an engineer, you'd probably do it this way too. There are other ways to do math besides algebra. There's numerical methods, there's graphing, there's other things you can do. Well, if we had time, I'd love to show you all the different ways you can solve stuff besides just algebra. All right, we've been doing geometric series only the last couple days, and then there was other activities going on at the school, so. Yeah, this one's a bit tough. I wouldn't ask them this hard, considering we've only done like 80% of the unit. So, you're told what T3 and T6 is. Or some books call it A3 and A6. And you're asked to find the sum of the first 10 terms. Well, you only got one formula to find the sum, and in order to do it, you need to know the first term. Well, in order to find the first term, you're going to have to find out what the R is. And how do you find out what the R is, the common ratio? Like, you don't have two things next to each other, so you can divide, you know, if you had T4, you could see the common ratio was T4 divided by T3. But you don't have T4, you got T3. So you've got to find out what the R is that multiplies negative 160, what, 1, 2, 3 times to get 10,240. So there's what you got to do. You got to find out what is this constant number, this R, that when you multiply it 3 times with negative 160, you end up with 10,400. Well, that's pretty easy to solve. So what you're saying is negative 160 times R 3 times, which really means R times R times R, has to give you 10,240. So doesn't that mean that R cubed is, dividing by 160, negative 64? What number multiplied by itself gives you negative 64? And use your calculator or use your noggin. You know it's going to be something usually fairly easy, all right, just for the sake of simplicity and to make, you know, make it more illustrative. It turns out it's negative 4. So check it out. If you took negative 40 and multiplied it by negative 4, you get positive 640. Multiply it by negative 4 again, you get negative 2,560. Multiply it by negative 4, you get the 10,240. So then going backwards to find term 2, you're not going to multiply by 4, you're going to divide by negative 4. So dividing negative 160 by negative 4 becomes 40, dividing by 40 by negative 4 becomes negative 10. There's your first term, negative 10. Oh my goodness. Little bit of work. Oh yeah, if you're not sort of sketching this stuff out on a bunch of placeholders, well, you're not doing a heck of a lot of math. If you're just expecting to smash things into a calculator and come up with an answer, that's not math. All right. So I've told you that before. You gotta be sketching things out. So let's call up that formula. Here's the sum of a geometric series. The sum of a geometric series is A times 1 minus R to the N, close brackets, all divided by 1 minus R. In other words, the first term times 1 minus the r to the n divided by 1 minus r. So let's just mash in the numbers here. Here they come. And this is all in green there. We started running out of room. And you got to be careful with these subtracting negatives. All right? Look in the denominator there. That's a 1 minus a negative 4. That's really a 5. Taking away a negative is adding. So that's really 5 in the bottom. And you get some pretty ugly numbers when you're doing geometric series, right? Look how you got in the top there, you got 1 minus 1,048,576. Well, you know, they get big. What can I tell you? These are RBFNs. When you do the math, the sum of that entire, the first 10 terms of that series is 2,097,150. You could have done it the long way and just kept generating T7, T8, T9, T10, and added them all up on a calculator. And don't forget that R stands for the common ratio. I think it says that on your cheat sheet. I wonder who asked that question. It says it on your cheat sheet. You got to be familiar with your cheat sheet. Now, that was a fairly tough one. That was a lot of work, and, you know, it took me a while. Chances are I'd only ask you something simple like this. I tell you the first term, and I tell you it was a geometric series, and I tell you the second, third, fourth term, and then I'd say, what's the tenth term? Right? So that looks pretty easy. You could just do it without... You could do this without any fancy formulas even, right? Recursively, right? Isn't the next number going to be 80, then 160, then 320, then 640, then 1280, then... Is it? The answer going to be 2560, for goodness sake. Or did I do that enough? 5,0, 5,120. Let's just do the math. Let's do the fancy formula. The fancy formula says if you want to know the nth term, you take the first term, the A, and multiply it by R raised to the N minus 1. In other words, to get from the first term to the nth term, you made N minus 1 hops to get to it. So that means you multiplied it by R N minus 1 times. So just plug in. So the 10th term is the first term, which is 5. And you're multiplying it by the r. Well, what's the r? Looks to me like we're just doubling, right? 5 doubled is 10. 10 doubles 20. 20 doubled is 40. And you're raising that to the 10 minus 1, which is 9. So you end up with 2,560. Which you could have done just by keep doubling all the terms recursively in front of it. Now, if I asked you for the 101st term, yeah, you wouldn't want to be doing that recursively. You'd want to actually use that explicit formula that lets you go direct to any term. Okay, now these are the two-parters. These are the two-part problems. They give you the formula. I'll always give you the formula. So the number of wood ticks you have, A for amount, I guess, is the P, the initial population, times E raised to the RT, where R is the rate of change, in other words, how much they reproduce. I think it works out to be 13% per day in this case, times the T, and DT is in days. Okay, so the first clue they give you is they say, well, you start with 103 wood ticks on your dog. 10 days later, there's 2,302 wood ticks, because my dog attracts all the wood ticks. So that will help us calculate the R, because they told us the final amount, they told us the initial amount, they told us the T for the time, so that'll help us calculate the R, so we can calculate the reproduction rate. So there we go. We're on the right there in green. So 2,302 is 103 times E raised to the R times 10. Find the R. There's only one unknown in there, it's the R. Right? E is just a number, it's 2.718, blah, blah, blah. We could have done all this in a base 2. It works out that E is better. Trust me. So find R. So how do you find R? Well, we're trying to get the R by itself, so we need the E to the R 10, raised to the R 10 by itself. So we got to get rid of that 103. Divide both sides by 103. And this time I'm going to take the natural log, the ln, the ln of both sides, because if any time you're using the e for the base, use the ln, the natural ln, to undo it. You could do the base 10 log, but it'd get kind of messy at the end, because when you do the base 10 log of e, it's going to be some ugly number, like, oh man, it'll be 0.4 or something or other, yeah. Right, the reason we did ln, natural log, because the natural log of e is 1. What power are you to put on an e to get an e? How about 1? So see how we're getting closer to getting that r by itself? So r is getting close by itself. Coming at you. So dividing both sides by 10. So there you go. Here she comes. There's your r. So now that tells you your birth rate. Oh, it's not 13%, it's 31%. Those wood ticks are growing at 31% per day. Every day there's 31% more, in addition to the ones that are there, 31% more than the ones that you had the day before. So that R is their reproduction rate. Now you know what that R is. You can use it to calculate, well, when would I have 7,500 wood ticks? And yeah, we could have actually done this all in the proportions. No, we couldn't have. We had to do it this way. So now you're redoing the same math, but now you know the R, and you're trying to find the T. So back to the same equation. So you know that you want to know when you have 7,500 wood ticks, but you started with 103. And you know there are now, the reproduction rate is 31% times the T. How many unknowns are in that equation there on the left in purple there? There's only one unknown, the T. Right? E is a number, 2.718, whatever. Divide both sides by 103. All right, now we got the exponential expression by itself on the left, and I jumped a few steps. I did the ln of the right side, and I popped the exponent down in front, so it looks like that. And the ln of E is really just 1. There you go, ln of E's 1, and same steps as on the right side there. When we calculated the R, we get the T by itself by dividing both sides by decimal 31068. Bada bing, bada boom, you find out T is 13.8 days. All right, there you go. So that's a two-part question. I don't know if I ask two-part questions. That's just too annoying. Too hard to mark. All right. The fact remains is you calculated the rate at which they multiply, and then you use that rate in the second step to calculate, so when would they be a certain number? So there would be 7,500 wood ticks in my backyard after 13.8 days, given that it only took 10 days to get to 2,302 wood ticks. All right, so if you're going to be in science or chemistry or nursing or anything with things that grow, like bacteria or germs or something, you got to sort of understand this stuff, that things grow exponentially. Or business admin, finance, money grows like this too. Oh, good. A little break here. Just do some counting. Oh, counting is so easy. So just draw your placeholders and draw a little hockey sock and throw your letters in it there too. If you're not drawing when you're doing math, you're not doing it right. So you got two possibilities, either vowel, consonant, vowel, consonant, vowel, or consonant, vowel, consonant, vowel, consonant. So there's two possibilities, one or the other. Did you hear that word or? It means add later at the end. So count your possibilities. There they go. Now we got sucked in here. We were thinking you're just going to take this 480 and double it, but it didn't quite work that way. No, it didn't. Watch what happens here. You don't just double that 480. Curious. Ends up being 1200. Yeah. That's what the math says. Go with the flow. Oh, and don't we love these? Find the ninth term. All right, so here's something raised to the tenth. Here's a binomial raised to the power of 10. So you know there's 11 terms added together. All right, so there's going to be 11 terms. We only want the third one from the end, right? The ninth term. Believe it or not, it's the third one from the end. Anyway, the formula is that term k plus 1 is equal to n choose k times the a there, whatever the first part of the binomial is, raised to the n minus k, times the b, whatever the second term is in the binomial, raised to the k. Notice that the k, whatever the k is in the n choose k, is going to be the k on the exponent of the b. It's pretty hard to screw this up. And notice the n minus k is whatever is left over from the n after you use up the k. Because notice that n minus k plus k is n. So they've got to add up. So the power, the exponent on the a and the exponent on the b have to add up to the n. Anyway, so if this is the k plus 1th term, the ninth term, that means the k is 8. So you know you got to do 10 choose 8. And the reason you're doing 10 choose 8, choose 8 is the ninth term, because when you start doing your coefficients using these combinations from Pascal's triangle, it turns out they start counting with 10 choose 0. So since the first term is 10 choose 0, the ninth term is 10 choose 8. That's why you got to do this k plus 1 prep. Anyway, 10 choose 8 is 45. That's, you can actually do that in your head pretty easy. Now it's 2x, all of 2x raised to the 2, or 10 minus 8. It's not just the x raised to the 2, it's 2x all raised to the 2. And then obviously here you got 1 over x to the 24, because that 8 can come inside and operate on the numerator and the denominator. So you really get 1 to the 8th divided by x to the 24th. And 1 to the 8th, by the way, somebody, is 8 is 1. 1 to the 8th is 1. You can multiply 1 by itself all day long. So you end up with 45 times, well, that 2x all raised to the 2 is really 4x squared. And then you just got 1 over x to the 24th, because 1 to any power is just 1. So it looks like about 180 divided by x raised to the 22. That was a bit tough. I wouldn't quite be that mean just because I'd mess it up myself if I was wigging out on an exam. But as long as you show your work, I pretty much give you full marks just for showing your work. I'm not going to penalize you for having one little brain fart. And somebody asked, well, what was this about x squared divided by x to the 24 being x to the negative 22? Well, there you go. There's an x squared in the top, and here's 24 x's in the bottom. Pretend. So don't two of those x's in the bottom cancel out two of the x's in the top? Don't you really have 1 over x to the 22? Or if you think about the law from grade 10, a to the m divided by a to the n is a to the m minus n. So using that logic, x squared divided by x 22 raised to the 22 is going to be x to the negative 22. And then using that other rule, you know, x to the negative 22. X to the negative 22 is the same as 1 over x to the 22. Yeah, you had to remember those rules in grade 10. And they're on your grade 12 cheat sheet, too. The exponent rules are all on the very top line, just in case you've done a brain dump on the exponent rules in grade 10. And then here's a whole hockey sock full of questions that we never got to. We'll do them normal. I'll just let them run in this video, in case you want to try them ahead of time. These are more reasonable questions, these. I'm thinking that's B. Find the sun treehouse. Oh man, I can't do that one in my head. Is there one we can get rid of? It's not A for sure. That's clear. This point must be on the graph 2. Ooh, 2 minus x. That's the same as. Oh, that's sneaky. That's negative x plus 2. Oh, what's this one? And this one is going to be. I'm thinking. Oh, missed it. Yeah, I'll let this run. These are going too quick for me to do in my head. Oh, I love this one. Well, it's 17, right? The exponent's 16, so since you start counting with 0, there's going to be 17 terms. This is pretty easy. Cotangent's really 1 over tan, then cosecant's really 1 over sine. So you have 1 over tan, 1 over sine, so tan side of. It's going to be 1 over. It's going to be secant. Duh. Okay. Blah, blah, blah. So we're going to flip that upside down, so it's going to, it's going to have an asymptote there where the mother function is 0. 2 raised to 3x, that's really 16 to the 2 to the 4, so 3x equals 4, so x equals 4 thirds. Sine of that, state the, So where does the sine equal 1? Oh, duh. How about at 90 degrees? There's only one answer. Blah, blah, blah. What are we doing here? Shifting that for right the equation. So 4 reflecting, so x's become negative x's, and the y's get added to 4. Well, that one's easy. 39 is 3. The base 10 log of 1,000 is 3, because 10 times 10 times 10. 40 is easy. It's 1. Isn't 8 choose 5 the same as 8 choose 3? Check it out. It's true. 42. Solve. Oh, my goodness. Not enough time to do that in my head. Clearly. Oh, that's pretty easy. Graphing the tan. Yeah, that's got a bunch of asymptotes at pi and 2 pi and 3 pi and 4 pi. Negative 2x. So we're going to flip it horizontally, and then we're going to stretch it vertically. So, yeah, that'll work. Graph is showing absolute value, so that'll be easy. It's just the left-hand side there gets kinked back up. Only the negative y's get stretched, so that'd be easy. Not stretched, kinked back up. Because, whatever. Blah, blah, oh yeah, I need my... don't have enough time to do that in my head. This one's easy. A equals R theta. You only know one formula. Plug it in. Oh, that's it. Sweet. All right, so there was a bunch you could practice with. If you don't get time, we'll be finishing those up tomorrow. End of the video. Hope that helped disengage now.